Come on, just offer your whole self to Him right now. Come on, just give your whole self to Him right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just offer everything to Him right now. Jesus, all of me for all of you. All of me for all of you. All of me for all of you. You know, on the night that I got saved, I was in my bed. I was an 8-year-old boy, and I was all alone in my bed. And this is my prayer. This was my salvation prayer. It wasn't very theological. It wasn't very precise, but I knew that Jesus was real and that He was Lord. And my prayer was, God, it was just this, God, I want everything You have for me. I wonder, it's a dangerous prayer right there, but I wonder maybe if you'd like to join me in that prayer this evening. If it's in your heart, would you just lift up your face to heaven, lift up your hands? Would you just say that, God, I want everything You have for me. God, I want everything You have for me. I don't want to miss out, Lord, not even on the least little bit. I want everything You have for me, Lord. Come on, Paul said, I press forward to take hold of that for which Christ took hold of me. Come on, God, I want everything that You have for me. I want to fulfill, Lord, that purpose for which You called me. I want everything You have for me. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Now would you give Him praise one more time in this place? Come on, just love Him right now. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Lord. God bless you, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to Harvest Time Church. I'm glad you're here. Welcome to everyone that's here on live stream, both from our Harvest Time family and our Greenwich Outpouring family. And I think we have some Aussies watching from halfway around the world. God bless you. Everybody wave to the folks from Australia. Let them know that we love our brothers and sisters in Christ over there. Would you take just a minute or two? I want you to just bless 5 or 6 or 7 or 8 people. Count. Make sure that it's at least 5, 6, 7, or 8. Bless them in the name of the Lord while you find your seat this evening. But I just love being in God's presence with God's people. I love being in God's house. You know what? It's way better than the Olympics. It's way better. I don't even know what's on television on Monday night, but whatever it is, this is way better to be in the presence of the Lord. Well, this is our last night with our friends David and Royree Jensen, and what a wonderful weekend that we've had just sharing with them. Chris, I've just got a little ring back coming. I don't know where it is on the platform, but maybe you can find it. It's just ringing back a little bit. We've had such a precious weekend with David and Royree. What great ministry they have brought to us, ministering to our ladies Saturday morning in 4 worship services, Saturday night, 3 Sunday morning, last night, and every time Royree has just brought us a great word. And I want to say that our fellowship with them has just been so rich. In fact, if you're watching live stream from Australia tonight, we love them so much that we're not letting go of them. So we're just, I have the keys to the car, so we're going to just keep them right here. But it's been such a precious time. If I haven't met you, my name is Pastor Glenn. I'm the pastor here at Harvest Time Church, and we welcome you this evening. David and Royree Jensen are with us from Logan City, Australia. Royree is the senior pastor of River of Life Church in Logan City. She is also the overseer of the HIM Apostolic Network in Australia, in the Pacific Islands, and in India, oversees many churches, has missions. Maybe she'll take 2 or 3 minutes and tell us about some of the missions work that they do in India. And I think that there is some information, there's some books that Royree has written that are out on the table. She shared a little bit about them last evening. But also there's just some information about their ministry. And if you'd like to connect with their ministry, and I already hooked up with them on Facebook and on every which way you can link with them. But if you'd like to follow David and Royree and just be a part of what they're doing, what their ministry is doing, I want to encourage you to just one more time get on your feet and give your best welcome this evening for our friends, David and Royree Jensen.
Well, thank you so much, Dave, say g'day.
Yeah, g'day. Well, Pastor Glenn, I'm sure that if you've got the keys to the car, if my daughter comes over here, she'll find them. Because you'll have to fight her to keep us. And she'll be one that's watching. So she will have heard you say that. You know, the time's come to an end here with you. And it just seems to have flown so quickly. And we've enjoyed our time with you here. And, you know, it's great to be around the other side of the world and to just come in and feel at home with people of like mind. And you guys could fit in very easily in our place back home. And indeed, if you're traveling any time, you're most welcome. So without any further ado, I'm going to give it to Royree, and she's going to bring us some fire, I think, tonight.
You know, there's God encounters in the room tonight. I can smell smoke. I think the burning bush dweller arrived while we were worshiping. Yay. Today I was hearing a little bit from one of your pastors about the outpouring here in Greenwich. Was it 2 years ago? Whoa. It actually hasn't gone anywhere. It hasn't gone anywhere. Do you know what? Your expectation was lifted to another level, and the next outpouring will just lift it a bit higher. The last outpouring hasn't gone anywhere. What are you all doing here on a Monday night? What am I doing here sniffling in the pulpit? It's the presence of the Lord. You know, it's just, we just melt in His presence, eh? Just something happens here last night. I don't know what time everyone went, but just lying on the floor like for so long after the service had finished. It's only hungry people that do that. Everybody else wants to go home, watch the Olympics, you know, but there's just such a hunger here, and I can taste it and I can feel it. And just saying to you guys back home, g'day guys, and it's the same, eh? There's bushfires all over the world, kindling all over the world, and all the Lord needs is for somebody to drop a match, and she's going to go kapoom. Hey, well, Pastor Glenn asked me to share a little of the work in India, because we've spoken a fair bit about Bougainville, and to share a little of the work in India tonight, and then I want to just bring you a message from the Lord, and then I think we should all just come up and snot on the carpet again and just wait in His presence. I don't think we can do anything better than that. But our work in India began in 1985, so that was before some of you were born. And we went to India to just help on a team over there. Actually, it was a team from America. and a few Aussies went to help. And we started preaching on the streets. And I think it's not hard to get a crowd in India if you can just get all the passers-by to stop for 20 minutes, 15 minutes, 10 minutes. You've got a crowd instantly. With it, you've got all the goats and the sheep and the water buffalo and everything all mixed in there. But people will actually hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, you're not allowed to just stand on the streets and preach there anymore. You'll end up in the slammer, the jail. Do you have a slammer? Yes. You do. Okay, got that one right. But that's how we started. And as time went by, I got a letter from this Indian man, and he had written something on a piece of paper that had my picture kind of embedded into the paper. And I didn't recognize it at first, but when I viewed it differently, I thought, what's he done? Well, one of my kids was over there and had given this guy a picture of me. And Indians are pretty good at PR. And they, you know, he'd done out this piece of paper with an invitation and an offering to give me his orphanage. And he had already put my name on it. And I'm like, inheritance is one thing. This is crazy. You know? And so here it is with the Royree Jensen orphanage. It's now called the Royree David. And I was just going to throw it in the bin. And as I did, the Holy Spirit spoke to me. And there were, I don't know, maybe about 20 or 30 kids at that stage. And so I picked it back up out of the bin, the trash, and I said to the Lord, do you know what? I don't want a bunch of snotty-nosed kids in some rundown orphanage that's got my name on it. And the Holy Spirit said to me, how do you think I feel? All the rundown stuff around the world that's got my name on it. And so we went, we had a look, we prayed, and we began to get involved with this orphanage. And then also churches began to form from the gospel that we'd been preaching on the streets. And I had no plans for a work in India. I had no plans to look after churches in India or orphans or anything else for that matter. But you know, sometimes God hijacks you. Sometimes he just sets up a Holy Ghost hijack and he gets you involved whether or not you plan to be, because he can see further down the track than what we can. And so in looking, in going to see this orphanage, and it was literally a pile of bricks. That's all it was. And so bit by bit, we were able to put up a building of some sort, and we've progressed from there. We went from a few kids to 75 kids, orphans. And I said to the guy who's looking after the orphanage, mate, that's enough. You know, we've got to cap it somewhere. There's like billions of kids here, and we can't look after them all. So cap it at 75, eh? I thought that was pretty good. Well, we were over there a year or so back, and this guy says to me, oh, Pastor, I'm wanting to tell you something, Pastor. And then he goes, oh, Mom, I am wanting that you hear my heart, Mom. And I'm straight away going, the guy wants more money, right? You know? But he started to tell me about 50 children who had been left as orphans all of a sudden when a great flood had come through that area. They call it the desert, but in actual fact, it's just a big floodplain. And what had happened was that the whole area flooded, as it often did. The parents had taken their children out to higher ground, and then they had gone back in to get all their possessions. And while they were in getting their possessions, the floodwaters just rose and took them away, and they've never been seen since. Well, I didn't know the fullness of the story, but here's this man trying to get me to come and look at another 50 orphans. And I'm like, if I go, I know I'll get sucked in, right? So I'm standing there debating whether or not to go. I'm at the door, and Dave says to me, well, what are we going to do about this? And I said, look, I don't know whether to go, because if I go, I'm a goner. And then we've got another 50 kids to look after, and then I've got to raise another 50, you know, whatever. So just as I'm about to go, a text comes through on my phone, and it's a friend of mine from Australia who didn't know I was in India. She was from the other side of Australia. She sends me a text. I read the text so many times I can pretty much remember it off by heart. The text said to me, "Royree, I've just had a dream about you. And this was my dream. I dreamed that I was on your sheep station. And you had been out mustering. And you came back and you said that there were a lot of sheep who were too weak and tired and sick to come in. And I offered to go out and get them for you. But you said, no, it's my responsibility to go and get all the sheep that are out there and bring them in." And she said, as the text went on to say, that there was also in the dream someone on a motorbike with a square headlight. Come on, it's a dream, okay? Don't look at me like that. It's a dream. So I'm there with this text, basically from the Holy Spirit, saying there's more sheepies out there. You got to go round them up and bring them in. And so we went. We took a lot of food. We took bags of rice and chickens and kids' toys and everything. And we went on this journey across the floodplain in an ox cart, just an old ox pulling along a wooden cart with wooden wheels. Oh, a lot of fun, especially if the oxen go on the way. We're sitting at the back. We went across. We went across and we met these kids. And seriously, they were the most ragtag little bunch of kids you ever did see. And we had all this food. And so we sat them down under a big mango tree or something and gave them a meal. We actually cut up banana leaves for plates. And we gave them their chicken and rice and soft drink and all sorts of rubbish, because I believe in rubbish. I think all kids should have some rubbish. It's good for their immunity. And so we gave this, and I'm sitting down, unable to speak with any of them because they speak a whole other dialect. But I was sitting down watching the kids. And as I was sitting there, I think for the first time in my life, I experienced something from the Father. You know, I know the Father loves me, and I'm very pleased about that. But you know, as I sat there and I watched these kids just feeding their little faces with their hands on them, I actually felt the Father's good pleasure. And I felt the power of the pleasure of the Father. And so we have taken on these extra kids by not taking them on as in paying for each one of them, but just putting a bit more rice and a bit more flour and a bit more water in. And the thing was that the kids, after the death of their parents, had been absorbed into the village life to some extent. And it worked for a while, but once the novelty was over of having extra children in your house, the orphan children became the servants in the house, and they became the last ones to be fed. So what we've been able to do is to get homes for the kids so that they can be kids and not servants. And so my heart in India is with the kids. We have many churches, but the Lord's just put the orphan children on my heart, and it's just been an experience of the Father's good pleasure. And when you think that, you know, there's something that you're really not called to do, but God keeps sticking it in front of you, like these orphan kids. Let's stop at 30. Okay, let's definitely stop at 75. Okay, here's another 50. I'm like, shoot the cat, you know, how many more kids? And it's not, I don't want the kids. It's just there's a responsibility to look after them, you know. And so from saying no to the Holy Spirit, because I didn't want a bunch of snotty-nosed kids with my name on it, the Holy Spirit has gotten rid of that lump of pride, because that's what it is. And and moved in compassion in our church and actually around the world. People are helping to support these orphan kids. We feed them, we clothe them, we send them to school. And since we've been doing it for a long time, we've had the opportunity now to see some of the kids that were on the city dump now actually finishing their education and becoming nurses or teachers or whatever. So that's some of the stuff that we do in India. India is just, it is just a mishmash of complexities which I don't understand. Even though I've been going there for so many, many years, I just don't get it. But the people are awesome and they love God and they're paying great sacrifices there even at this time for their faith and for their belief in God. They're being persecuted by the Hindus, they're being persecuted by the Muslims, but they're actually reaching out. And when we baptize some of them in the local drain, right there with the water buffalo, you know, the police were at our door the next day. It's all a lot of fun. Like I said, you don't want to live too conservatively. Run a few risks. Give it a go. And when you're dead, you'll be glad that you didn't just suck oxygen off the planet while you were alive. You did something. You know, so enjoy. Hallelujah. And you know this fire of God that's in the house, that's here, that is tangible. It's a tangible presence of the Lord in this place. You know what? It will end in you going. It doesn't matter where you're going to go, but it will end in you going. You cannot touch the Father. You cannot touch the fire. You cannot receive the Spirit without that compulsion that is within Him getting on you, and you start to go out. Wherever it is to, you start to go out. And for some, it's in the immediate neighborhood. For others, you know, it's in politics or somewhere, but there's this go in the gospel. And I gotta say, I love India. I don't understand it, but I'm gonna keep going, and we're gonna keep going. And I hope nobody in India is watching this, especially my guys over there. But we'll probably increase from the number that we have now and keep on going with the orphans. I marvel at people like Heidi Baker who are just, shoot the cat, just doing such an enormous, amazing, wonderful work. I just think it's awesome. It's just powerful. So I don't know how she does what. Anyway, hey, it's the touch of God on her life. That's what it is. But you know, there's a touch of God for you. We may not all be able to be Heidi Bakers, but we can be, put your name in there. We can all be who you are. You know, you can be who you are. That's all that God requires of you. He's made you the way you are. And so much more I could say of India. If you ever get an opportunity to go on a team to India, it is a place for extravagant evangelism. You know, you just need to tell them, hey, it's that, because if they receive Jesus, they put a picture of Jesus up on the wall right there with all the other gods. They got a wall full of gods, and Jesus now is there as well. So we have to say to him, he is the only God. He is the living God. You know, so, you know, get rid of all that other junk. He's the one. And you'll see people that will be so anxious to know what you have to give to them that they will literally come out of the windows and the doors of their houses and chase you down the street. I kid you not. And want you to come and pray for their sick. Their sick kids, their sick cow, their whatever else. So I know this is that we've had the missions weekend up until now, but let me just give you one last blast. If you get the opportunity to go to a place like India or a place like Papua New Guinea or even to the Ecuador ministry that you're going to be, is it July that you're going? July, there's a team from here going to Ecuador. It's amazing. Get on board with missions. Get on board with missions and you'll sense the heart of the Father pumping custard through you. You know, you'll just sense the heart of the Father. Well, I want to share with you tonight. When I heard about the outpouring of a couple of years ago, my heart started racing today. Because I thought, well, it hasn't gone anywhere. You know, it's still right here. And for so many of you to be out on a Monday night, that's just, you know, that's mega. But to the increase of his government, there's no end. And to the increase of the glory, there is no end. And to the increase of what he wants to do in this place, there is no end. And I know that the next move, the first move was about wine. The next move is about fire. And the one after that will be about wind. And we've had the wine of his presence for decades now. And it's shifting gears to go from wine to fire. And we're touching the fire of God. We're touching the fire of God. We're touching the fire of God. And we want to get cooked. We want to get cooked. You know, over this weekend, I've had the privilege to share with you some of the things that we've done in missions, some of the things that are happening in Australia, some of the wonderful miracles and signs that we've seen in 40 years of ministry. But I've got to tell you this, people, I will lay it all down in a heartbeat, to be in the next move of God. I'll lay all that stuff on the altar and God can cook it and we can forget all about it because the fire's coming. The fire is coming. And you know what? Fire is attracted to sacrifice. Fire is attracted to sacrifice. Why should God throw fire over from heaven? If there's nothing on the altar to burn, we are his burning ones. And there's a fire that's enveloping us. And I'm the first one to say, Lord, I don't have that absolute passion of fire where I am all consumed. You know? But I want that. I want that. With all my heart, I want that. Because I'm too old to mess about anymore. You know, I want the real thing, and I don't want to get left behind in moves of God. When the charismatic move came, I was with the Brethren movement, and partly I was on the mission field as well, and we sat back to see if this thing be of God or not. Well, this thing did be of God, and we missed the whole thing, you know. So jump in both feet. And everything that I am and everything that I have, he can have all that stuff because it's stuff, you know. And you might get a crown for it in glory, but at the end of the day, we're just going to cast our crowns down anyway. So what the heck, you know. Well, let me tell you a story. Is that okay? Once upon a time, about 2,500 years ago, before any of you were born or even your grandmother was born, there lived in a wicked land a big bad king. He was power hungry and he picked on all the little people around about him. He was power hungry and he picked on all the little nations around about him. And he beat the yogurt out of them. And he took the best of all their young people and brought it back to his place and he made slaves of them. So you can see he's not your average Mr. Nice Guy. And so one of those nations that he stole the best from was the nation of Israel. He came and he took back to his nation the very best that Israel had. Now, to be fair, I've got to tell you, that the prophets in Israel and Judah had been warning the people that the Babylonians are coming to get you, and there's a big bad king and his name's Mr. Nebuchadnezzar. And they're coming to get you, and you'll end up in Babylon unless you repent of behaving the way you've been and chucking rocks at the prophets and chucking them down the well and then sawing them in two and through a hollow log. You know, not a good look, but that's what happened to the prophets in those days. God help you if you got your prophecy wrong. Well, the king of Babylon had come with his army. And he'd taken all these guys who actually scoffed at the prophets, who had warned them that he was coming. And they said, the people of Israel said, look, we don't want any unpleasant talk around here. Don't tell us the Babylonians are coming. Don't upset the apple cart. You know, we're good. So just leave us alone. We don't want to hear that stuff. And they actually literally threw Jeremiah down the well. And they did actually cut Isaiah down the middle. You know, if you're into that stuff. So now, these guys are on their way to Babylon. But you know something really big time? Excuse me, just been crying in worship. There we go. Won't shock the Aussies. See, at the same time that the king is taking the young men of Israel back to Babylon, God is fulfilling the words, the very words that the prophet had spoken. And not only that, but he's going to erode the kingdom of Babylon, of which Nebuchadnezzar was the king, and he's going to do it from the inside out, because God is pretty big on multitasking. And while he's doing this, he's also doing that and doing the other thing, and we don't have a clue. We only see one part of what he's doing, and we don't get the other side of it, and we complain and whinge and carry on all the way through it, and then at the end we look back and we go, oh, Jesus, thank you, that was God. That was so you, God. We knew it was God. Oh, we knew. We know we didn't. We had the pip. We were cheesed off and we thought God had gone somewhere. So little did King Nebi know, but this was the greatest security breach in human history. This was the Trojan horse situation. The king himself is leading into his kingdom the very people who can demonstrate to him a superior king and a superior kingdom right under the king's nose. They're going to show off and they're going to erode the empire of Babylon, God's people. So, Mr. Nebuchadnezzar, seriously, you have been sucked in. So, let's go to, if you've got your Bibles, chapter 3 of Daniel. If you haven't got your Bibles, you're just going to have to believe what I'm saying. So Daniel chapter 3, this is what happened. This is one of the stories that you knew from Sunday school. See, this same king had just set up a great big image of himself. Sometimes we tend to do that. He just set up this great big image of himself, 90 foot high. That's pretty big, you know. And he wants everybody to bow down and do the Nanu Nanu thing to him. See? Because he's the king. And he likes the Nanu Nanu. Well, there's three blokes that were in this mob that had been taken from Israel. There's three guys. And they go, oh, probably not. We're probably not going to bow down to that thing. You know the story. Their names were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Or in Australia, they say, my shack, your shack, and a bungalow. We're trying to be reverent, we just haven't quite got there yet. Or shack the bed, mac the bed, and into bed you go. That's a better one. So the king's upset that these three blokes won't bow down and do nanu nanu to him. And so the king goes, okay, I'm going to chuck you in the fire. I'm going to chuck you in the fire. So, verse around about 16, we'll start there. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God whom we serve is able to deliver us. But if not, we're still not going to bow down, so there. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your God or worship the image of gold that you have set up. You know, sometimes when you're serving the Lord and sometimes when you're in a tight spot, like the church is beginning to get into tight spots with a lot of the laws that are being passed now, and sometimes you get pushed to the brink because of your strong convictions. And you're made to feel like you're the guilty one, you're the one that's wrong, you're the one that's whatever. Well, look, just keep in mind that if it's not intimidating you a little, it's probably insulting to the Father. Because he sets us on a course where we have to walk through a lot of intimidation. And if you're not feeling intimidated, you're probably not on the stretch. And you're probably insulting the Father by thinking that, you know, he can't keep you in a place that's really difficult. Anyway, I thought that might help somebody or not, really. Shaka. So they're about to get thrown into this raging fire. Verse 19. Then Nebuchadnezzar was furious with my shack, your shack, and a bungalow, and his attitude towards them changed. And he ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than the usual and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in his army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. Listen, when threats are made, major threats are made against the church of God, and the church stands, it gets heaven's attention. These guys have said, listen, Mr. King, mate, whoever you are, our God is able to deliver us, but if not, we're still not going to bow down. We are not going to bow. And heaven hears it. So heaven's listening over the veranda there. And the king's talking about hotting it up 7 times hotter. And the sevenfold spirits of God are leaning over saying, that's got a familiar ring about it. 7 times hotter. Sevenfold spirits of the living God. Let's go join the fire. Let's get involved in this thing. This looks a bit like a bit of fun. So the bluey is on. So reading on. So these men wearing their robes, trousers, turbans, oh, that's really good, I'm glad they were, and other clothes were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command was so urgent that the furnace so hot that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. Then the king Nebuchadnezzar leapt to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, "Weren't there three men that we tied up and threw into the fire?" And they replied, "Certainly, O king." And he said, "Look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the fourth one looks like the son of the gods." These guys went into the fire of testing. There could be some testing that comes to the church. It's okay. It's okay. And there's a fire of passion. And sometimes the flames look a little bit alike. Sometimes you go in with one and you come out with the other. And when the man of fire is present in the fire, the supernatural fire devours the natural fire. When the man of fire gets in the fire, the supernatural fire devours the natural fire. And that which is earthly, seven times earthly, is tamed and obeys the presence of the heavenly. Earthly fire requires oxygen. Heavenly fire requires the glory. So what happened in the fire? What happened in the fire? You see, Jesus, Jesus, the perfect one, the Lord, the King of glory, the owner of heaven and earth, the Son of the living God, stepped into the unquenchable fire. And I told you yesterday, the fire said, "I'm not hungry anymore." The natural fire said, "I quit. There's something here I can't digest." These guys are walking around singing and praising God. And they're singing, "I can feel revival coming on. I can feel revival coming on. I got the taste for it. I can't wait for it. I can feel revival coming on." These guys, they're not going to bow. They're not going to bend. And they're not going to burn. They're just not going to shift. They've already said, "Our God is able, and even if he doesn't, we'd rather have be cooked in the fire than bow down to your stuff." And there's an exchange of the earthly fire for the heavenly. And that which has bound them is burnt off them. They're seen to be unbound and unharmed. When the fire comes, that which has bound you will be burnt off you. The fire will prepare us for the pressure of promotion to the next move. The fire is going to prepare us for the pressure of promotion so that we are bold and we are not afraid of the king's edict. And we're not afraid of laws that are passed against us. We're not afraid. There are threats being made and they're going to throw you in the fire. Well, you can bet your bottom dollar that he's going to be in the fire with you. He's going to be in the fire with you. Nebuchadnezzar then approaches the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here." And they said, "No, come and get us." No, they didn't. See, the scripture says that when they come out, they saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was there a hair on their head singed, their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. They were not burned, they were not singed, they were not scorched, there was not even the smell of fire on them. What happened in the fire? What happened in the fire? Was the miracle in the taming of the fire? Or was the miracle that these men had entered into another realm and experienced an entree of what the heavenly spiritual body is like? Well, I don't know. Thought I'd put it out there, though. Thought there might be a theologian here with an answer. I don't know whether the fire was tamed while they were in it, or whether their bodies were changed to be able to tolerate the fire and even enjoy it. It doesn't matter. There was a miracle of God that happened, because there is a place where the supernatural embraces you when you embrace the supernatural. There is a place. There is a place by me where you can stand in the cleft of the rock. There is a place where you can embrace the supernatural, and then the supernatural embraces you. When you embrace a superior reality, your life begins to align itself with that potential. Come on, somebody say, Ripper Rita. When you embrace a superior reality, your life begins to align itself with the potential of that reality. And you wonder why some people walk in miracles. You wonder why some people do what they do. I tell you what, it's called risk, R-I-S-K. Faith is spelt R-I-S-K. They're willing to look like an idiot. They're willing to get it wrong. They're willing to say, oh, King, live forever and all the rest of it, but we don't really give a rip. Do what you will. We're not going to bow down. So there you go. And it's that kind of abandonment to the things of God that's coming, that is now and is yet to come. There is an abandonment to the Spirit of God. There is a risk-taking mob that are arising. There is a new generation. I'm not just talking about young people, because if the young ones think that they're going to have it all on their own, they've got this granny to contend with. I'm in. I'm in. You know that? It's not about age. It's just about who's going to run the risk. Who dares wins? Because who dares wins is about faith. It's about believing that we can have a go. And you know what? If you fall on your face a few times, who cares? Who cares? Does it really matter? After you've made enough mistakes, it doesn't matter anymore. After you've failed enough, you've got nothing but success to look forward to. So get on in. You know, just get on in. So what happened? Only three men came out. What happened to the fourth one? Just those three guys came out. Because if the fourth man had come out, the king would not be able to stand in his presence, nor would anybody else. Because this is the man of fire. He loves fire. He is fire. Our God is a consuming fire. He's fire from the waist up. He's fire from the waist down. So where did the fourth man go? Well, I don't know. But you see, he's very much at home in the fire. His eyes are like blazing fire. A river of fire proceeds out from before him. His face is like the sun shining in all its brilliance. His clothing is like lightning. We got serious fire happening around this man. And it's going to rub off on us, because as he is, so shall we be. We're just going to taste the awesomeness of the fire. His feet are like bronze glowing in the furnace. Hoo-wee. bronze is a combination of metal. You don't mine for bronze. You make bronze, so they tell me. Bronze is a combination of tin and copper. Tin, speaking of our humanity. Shaka. Copper is the best conduit of electricity and power that there is. So here's the very lightning of God and man coming together as one, as he stands, the man of fire in the presence. He's the man of fire. He's the man of fire. The fire is going to prepare the way for a promotion to the next level. You know, in Australia recently, I was telling someone the other night, not recently, it was over 12 months ago. But you know, recently is relative. Depends how old you are as to what's recent. A decade ago is pretty recent these days, you know. But there was in Australia what they called a fire-nado. It was a tornado of fire. It was in the center of our nation in the desert. There have been many signs and wonders that have been in our nation in recent days, and this was one of them. This fire-nado, it reached the news here in America, and it was said by the American newsreader that these fire-nados have been known to last for up to 1 minute. This fire-nado went for 40 minutes, and it was just a great pillar of fire. Whoosh! I don't know, how high was it, Dave? Just this massive pillar of fire, something like 400 feet up. And it was dancing all around the desert. And it sounded like the jet engines going by. And it just so happened that a Christian photographer who was looking for a place to do a commentary for Channel 7, he happened to be there with all his camera gear. I mean, what are the odds? This is Australia. There are hundreds of thousands of square miles of nothing. And one man with one truck full of camera equipment comes across in the desert a fire-nado. What's the odds? So he gets out his camera and he starts to film this amazing pillar of fire in the midst of our nation. And it hit headlines around the world. I'm taking it to be a sign and a wonder. This thing went for 40 minutes. This is amazing. I believe that all around the world there's going to be signs and wonders if we care to prophetically investigate them. You know, Moses, it said of Moses that he, when he saw the bush burning, he went over and had a look. And when God saw that he'd had a look, then God spoke to him. As if he wouldn't have had a look. Here's a bush burning but not being consumed. Of course he's going to go and have a look. But you know, not necessarily. We can see things prophetically that God gives to us and we don't turn aside and have a look. And we miss out on what God wants to show us. The Bible says, when the Lord saw that Moses had turned aside. I'm thinking that's a funny verse. Who wouldn't turn aside? And then the Lord reminded me of the things he's shown me and I didn't turn aside. I go, well, how stupid was I? So when you see something unusual, inquire of the Lord. Because we're on holy ground and sometimes we don't know it. I've been watching our guys in church preaching when I'm not there, so I'm talking to you guys. And even when I am there recently, and I've been noticing that the worship leader and one of the preachers, maybe a couple of them, are not wearing shoes. Now, in our day, that would have been a big no-no. Yeah, because you've got to kind of dress for the occasion. Thank God we've all gone a bit more casual lately. But you know what? I'm sitting there thinking about it. And the Spirit of the Lord said to me, leave them alone. They're on holy ground. And they know it, even if you don't. Okay. Go barefoot. Everyone go barefoot. I don't care. whatever it takes. Take off your shoes, for the ground on which you stand is holy. And this is what Moses heard. He could have missed it. He could have missed it, but he turned aside to have a look. And the fact that God was waiting to see if he would said that there was a high likelihood that maybe he was not going to turn aside. Because we do miss the prophetic explanations of God. Our God is a consuming fire. He led the people in a pillar of fire by night. He makes his angels winds and his servants flames of fire. He ascends on the sacrifice, on the flame, back to heaven when Samson's parents offered a sacrifice to him. Ezekiel saw him from the waist up, fire from the waist down, fire. He looked like he's glowing, like glowing metal in the midst of the whirlwind. If he's like this, if he's like this, and we draw close to him, it would be impossible for us not to be touched with the fire. The closer we draw, the greater the likelihood is that we are going to be touched by this amazing fire of the person, because we're learning of him in different aspects. And right now we're hungry to know him as the man of fire. So look out, he's going to cook us. Hallelujah. God, if you want to cook me tonight, it's really good. It's really good. I'm ready. Fire prepares the way for us. Scripture says, in the furnace of great affliction, I have chosen you. And so for iron, I'll give you silver. And for brass, I'll give you gold. I know it was talking to people who had been through testing and through trial. But somehow it seems to me, not so much a prerequisite that we go through a trial before we hit the fire, because that might cause us all to steer away from the whole thing, you know, because who wants a trial? But it seems as though the trials of our life somehow have a power in them. The fire, the furnace of affliction, somehow has within it a power to give us a hunger for the fire of God. So those things that have happened, those trials that have come, the times when you felt you were in the fire, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, chucked into a natural fire, and then experienced supernatural fire. There was no stopping these guys for the rest of their lives. We need the fire that's going to cause us to not stop for the rest of our lives. I think I told some meeting over the weekend that in Australia we have eucalypt gums. They're trees. They've just found that the leaves on the tree have gold at the edges. Whole other story. Amazing. Our gum trees, our common old gum trees, have been sucking up gold from underground and drawing it up through the sap and depositing it on the edges of the leaves. So they're talking about the potential and the possibility of farming gold. Not mining it, farming it. And one of the guys that was here, I think Pastor Jeff, actually saw it. You can Google it. Anyway, these gum trees that are everywhere in Australia, they're full of oil, full of eucalypt oil. And they're so full of this stuff that when we have a bushfire, they go off like a bomb, because they're just ready to be ignited and push, and the fire spreads everywhere, all over the place. And we have these incredible bushfires because of the oil that's in the eucalypt gum. As the Lord has anointed us with the Spirit, one comes after me, John the Baptist said, whose shoes I'm not worthy to undo, and he is going to baptize you with the Spirit, the oil of the Spirit, and with fire. And I see the gum trees as kind of, because I'm an Aussie and I can't help it, but I see it as kind of like an example of those of us who have been tanked up with the oil of the Spirit in the baptism of the Spirit, now getting ready for part two of this, where the fire will come and touch us and explode because of the anointing oil that we contain within us, because of our capacity to carry the anointing, the fire is going to easily explode in us. And we've been through the furnace of afflictions, many of us. So we're going to know the difference. But the furnace of affliction prepared us for a furnace of the Holy Ghost. And it's right here. When we started tonight, and I came in and I was so intent on what I was doing, I just walked past everybody, just had my eyes focused on something. Because as I walked in, I could feel God is in this house. God is in this place. I know the feeling. In fact, sometimes if I go into our church at home and I don't feel that, it's like, I just want to go home. I don't want to be here today. I want to go home. So the best thing we can do is praise and worship. And of course he comes, because he can't resist it. But when I walked in here tonight, I sensed the presence of the Lord. I sensed angelic beings. Look, I'm not sucking up to you. I've got no need to. I'm moving out tomorrow if the pastor lets me. But you know, if there are angels' presence, it's because he's present. Because when God comes, he comes with an entourage. You know, if a king in the natural or a president comes, he doesn't just walk down the street on his own. He's got 45 blooming, what do you call them? Thingies. Cars. He's got a great long entourage that precedes him. And if the Queen of England comes somewhere, she doesn't just walk in on her own. She's got a great entourage. If our Aussie Prime Minister comes into a room, somebody's probably going to say, "G'day, mate, how's it going today?" He doesn't have a big entourage, but we're changing that. The protocol thing sometimes escapes us. But here's the thing. If there's angels in the room, it's not just for the sake of you being able to say there's angels in the room. They're here to attend to the King of Glory. They can't resist being where he is. They hear the worship and they're outside in the snow. Of course they want to come in. It's cold out there. You know? So I came in and I was just intent because I felt the presence. I just began to weep in the worship because the overflow and the presence of God just touched my heart, people. I want to say, do you know what you've got here? Do you know what you've got? Do you know what's been built in the Spirit for you? You know, I go to a lot of churches and I don't want to criticize any of them. God bless them all. But sometimes there's a spirit of mold in them. And you could almost feel like you couldn't scrape the mold off, you know what I'm saying? But you walk in here and kapow, you're hit with the Spirit if you care to receive him. If you want to turn aside and have a look. If you don't, you'll miss it, but that's okay. Maybe catch it another time, but why would you wait for another time? His presence is here. Last night, we just sprawled on the floor. We just sprawled on the floor, and God was healing people and touching people and ministering to people and giving them prophetic words and pictures and visions. And people come and shared with me afterwards, and I'm like, wow, that's really cool. Wished I'd had one of them. But know that he's here. So come with faith. Come with faith. And let's make it our prayer tonight. And let's make it the desire of our heart, because sometimes you don't even have to use words, because God looks on our heart and he hears the groaning of our heart. Cook me, God. He hears the groanings and he hears the longings. And I'm sure as we worship tonight, there was such a longing in people's hearts and he's heard it. So let's come with an expectation And let's just request of him that he might turn up the flame, that we might experience the flame of his presence, the light of revelation in the flame, the heat of passion that's in the flame, and the power to explode that's in the flame. Because that's the move. That's the next move. We've been prepared for it by imbibing the wine and the oil. The wine and the oil. And we're moving into the next. Hallelujah. Father. Rabu selemu. Kubrashte keleveshte. Hisakahatu rumona mayande de lebo satahasi. Lord, we're hungry for you. We thank you for what you have already done. I want to thank you for the outpouring here in Greenwich a couple of years ago. I want to thank you that there's been a sustaining of that in the hearts and lives of people. I want to thank you, Lord, that it's not like, well, that dissipated and what's next. No, you're building upon what you've already done. You waste nothing. You're using the depth of what you've already done. And Lord, I want to say thank you. I want to say thank you. I want to express gratitude for the move of God that's been here. Lord, I just want to say yes. Yes. And Lord, I'm asking that you might come again in such a way that takes us from where you have brought us to into another place, a place of fire. And Lord, for those of us who might fear the flame, there's an anesthetic called joy. Shaka. There's an anesthetic called joy. And the flame will bring the passion and the joy of the Lord and build on what you already have. Shaka. Marashti. Father, I pray for those watching on live stream tonight that something of a hunger for the fire of God, something of the touch of the Spirit of the Lord that we've experienced here tonight might come upon them, and a hunger will be spread from this place to parts all around the globe. Lord, would you do again what you did with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Come with us, Lord. We dare to walk in the fire of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you'd like prayer tonight, just come. We're all going to pray together. We're going to pray for fire. We are going to pray for fire. We're going to pray for a deposit of the power of the Spirit. We need him. Well, God's looking for people who can handle the pressure of promotion. The pressure, the wonderful pressure of the Spirit of the Lord. So you know what? I think tonight, there's some intercessors here tonight. If you're an intercessor, would you just put your hand up? Can we have some intercessors come forward? Let the intercessors come forward. Just come right to the front, right to me. Kubra se televiste. Kebo sate nemo sakalabasi. Rabo hasate rakete. We just need to begin to intercede for fire. Woohoo! Shaka! Shaka! We just need to begin to intercede for fire. Because this is not just about me going around and praying over you. Because I'm as hungry as you are, and I got needs, and I'm preaching on it so that I can get it, not because I got it. I'm preaching so I can get it, not because I got it. So we're going to get the intercessors to begin to lead us, and we're going to join in with them We're going to join in with them and call out to the Lord. Call out to the Lord. Rabo sekele masse.
Wheat, 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 alabotante. Who knows you by name, God says. Holy is my name. Souls are coming. Change is here. Supper time. Holy time. God's time. No man gives this to you. I give this to you, God says. Chosen vessels of my love. Each one of you has been given a gift. A fiery holiness is about to be released. No man gives this to you. God is away. He's the chosen one. Twos. I've called you in twos. Lost. They're saying, fire on us, Lord. Prayers of the Father are upon you, children. Loose the seeds of fire upon you. Creation is mine, Jesus says. Who named you? I am with you always.
Let's just call out. Let's just ask the Lord. Come on. Come on. All of us, just begin to ask the Lord. Just begin to ask the Lord. Just begin to ask the Lord. Just begin. Lord, we're hungry and we're thirsty and we need the fire of your Spirit. Lord, we're hungry and we're thirsty and we say, fire, fall down. Fire, fall down. Let the fire of God come. Let there be an outpouring of fire. Let there be an outpouring of fire. Father, in the name of Jesus, let there be an outpouring of the fire of God. Let there be an outpouring of the fire of God. Lord, come. Come, Holy Spirit. Korabosete. Eleveste de lebo. Lamasi, lamasi. Shakalabasi de lebo.
Fire, 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 fire. Fire, holy fire, fall. Fire, fall, release, fire, fall, glory, fall, flaming ministers of fire, fall. I see angels touching people right now. Fiery ministers of flames right now. Burn us, holy God, burn us, fire, fall, fall, fire, hallelujah.
Shada Bahasi.
Father, roll, roll over the situation. Open your mouth with fire, Father, over our church, Lord. Hear our prayer. Crunch our thirst. Crunch our hunger, Father, with fire. We dig in fire, we dig.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. We just see the power of your awesome Holy Spirit. We see the fire of God, a consuming fire. A consuming fire, a consuming fire, a consuming fire, a consuming fire, a consuming fire. Lord, let your fire, let the fire of the Lord overwhelm us, Lord. Let the fire of the Lord overwhelm us. Let the fire of the Lord overwhelm us. Sir, shaka, shukubrasi, rusate, saka labasi. Come on, people, just ask the Lord. You won't get it from me, you'll get it from him. You won't get it from me, you'll get it from him. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Let the fire of your Spirit, let the burning fire of the Spirit, turn aside and have a look. 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 Turn aside. Turn aside and have a look. Turn aside from what you know. Turn aside from the ordinary and have a look and see the burning bush. See the burning bush. Turn aside from the and have a look. Turn aside. Turn aside. Turn aside. Have a look. There's a bush. It's burning. Shaka. The burning bush dweller is here. The burning bush dweller is here. The burning bush dweller. The burning bush dweller. He's in the midst. The burning bush dweller is in the midst of us. the burning bush dweller, the burning bush dweller, mate, the one who dwells in the burning bush, the holiness of God that dwells in the burning bush. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Shaka, 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 bahasika tahati, rabushte, rabushte, the burning bush dweller. Turn aside and have a look. 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 Have a look. Have a look for the burning bush dweller. Have a look for the burning bush dweller. Just have a look. Have a look. Have a look at him. Have a look at him. His eyes are like fire. His eyes are like fire. His feet are like bronze. His feet are like bronze in the furnace. His feet are like bronze. Turn aside and have a look at him. Turn aside and have a look. Turn aside and have a look at him. Turn aside, sir. Have a look at him. Saka labasi kata labasi. Raboshte. Turn aside and have a look at the burning bush dweller. Turn aside. Turn aside. Take time. Turn aside and have a look. Turn aside and have a look. Turn aside, mate. Turn aside. Turn aside, turn aside, turn aside. Have a look at the burning bush dweller in the name of Jesus. 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 Sir, the burning bush dweller, the one who dwells in the burning bush, him, he's calling you to turn aside. Turn aside, have a look. Have a look, he says, take off your shoes. For the ground whereon you stand, it's holy. It's holy. Holy. It's holy. It's holy. It's holy ground. We're on holy ground. There's a fire of holiness. There's a fire of holiness. There's a fire of holiness. Brushte. 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 There's a fire of holiness. There's a fire of holiness. Shaka. Just receive, just receive, just receive, just receive. You know, when people saw the fire and they turned aside, the burning bush dweller always brought about into their life a powerful holiness. When Isaiah saw the Lord high and exalted, the first thing he said was, woe, 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 woe is me. I'm undone. He was already a prophet of the Most High God. Well, I want to tell you that the Lord's just told me to tell you that the fire that's coming is going to bring such a depth of holiness. Not the old-time holiness of you don't go to see a movie and you don't read a newspaper and you don't wear makeup and you got to wear long skirts, all that stuff. It's going to be, we are going to be wholly given unto the Lord. We are going to be people who are consumed with Him. There's going to come a holiness in the pews that where people have had hidden sin, it will just be burnt with the fire. Where there have been addictions, that it's just going to get burnt with the fire of God. There's going to come such a deep, deep holiness. Not a snobbery, not a holier-than-thou kind of attitude, but a humility, a great humility accompanied by a great holiness in the presence of the Lord. And we shall be in awe of Him. We shall be in awe of Him. And we will come into the sanctuary and we're going to have to be helped in because of the holy presence of God in the sanctuary that we're just going to have to be helped in. We'll be stumbling and staggering under the glorious weight of His presence and under the holiness of who He is. I see it. I see people piled up at the doors. I see people unable to come in. I see some not daring to come in because of the awesome holiness of God. Oh, Shokubras, 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 Shada, 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 Damasita. Hey, hey, The holiness of God. The holiness of God. Oh, bless you.